Okay, so this is actually, I will approve a couple of Cauchy's integral formula in different setting. First of all, we need to introduce a concept called the index of a point with respect to a closed path. So let gamma be a closed path, okay? In the complex plane, and omega is the complement of the range, the gamma star, in the complex plane. So the situation is that quite open here. So you have a gamma star, okay, and so omega. This is. So consists of outside of the curve, this part. So the inside of curve divided into two parts is here and there. So by the range of a gamma, the whole plane is divided into three components actually, and so here. Consist of okay. So you can say that we have d zero here, we have d one here, and d two here. All right. So omega is equal to. Okay, and whenever we put a dot inside the union symbol, it means the disjoint union. Says that D1, D0, D1, D2, they are disjoint to each other. Okay, and so every component actually is a domain. Okay? And we know this is an open set. Okay, so omega is an open set, and this open set becomes to the joint union of three domains. Well, D1 and D2. So this is the situation. Of course, you can have many different types of cross curve. So by removing the range of the cross curve, the complement will consist of quite a lot of disjoint domains. Okay. So this is the situation. All right. Okay. So this is the case. Now, okay. Now, for each z in omega, so z is a point, right? It's a point not on the gamma star. Okay, just in omega. I just directly write it. We define a complex function. Okay, so it's called the index IND gamma z. Okay, so the definition. So it's 1/2 pi i. 1/2 okay, so that is a line integral, okay, over the closed path gamma. And the function here is 1 over cosine minus z. Okay? Now, z cannot be on gamma, otherwise, when cosine, when psi went through the when psi goes through the path, then at some point that cosine will be equal to z, and this will become too undefined. So we define a function. Okay. Z. Okay. So Z must be in the complement of the gamma star. Okay. And which is called the index. Of point z in omega with respect to the closed gamma. Okay, so this is called index. Indicator is index, okay, of the point z in omega with respect to the closed path gamma. All right, so it is a fun complex function that for every z in omega, right, this is the value, because we know that if z is not in omega, this is the continuous function. Okay, gamma star is a continuous function. Right, so this is well defined. Okay, so the line integral is well defined. So any questions for this definition? Yes? Oh, okay. Because the sine runs through gamma star, right? And the z, probably z here. So z is not on gamma star. So the difference never zero. Yeah. And so it is continuous, because this is just the reciprocal of the difference. So it is a function of cosine. So it's continuous. Yeah. Other questions? Okay. Now it can be shown that the index function IND Z is continuous. Okay, it's continuous on omega. Okay. Okay, and the proof is given in the supplemental material I sent to you last night. So yeah, so please go to see the detail. Okay, so I just skip that part. So basically, so it's very interesting that the index function by this definition is continuous. All right. Now, okay. Now we state the theorem. Call the winding number. Okay. Our index of a point is respect to a closed pair. Alright, so this theorem will characterize the index function. Alright, characterize the index function. So now, gamma, the closed pairs in the complex frame. Omega is C minus the range of gamma. Okay. Then the index function IMP gamma Z, okay, is an integer value is an integer value function on omega. Okay, so that which is constant in each connected component. I forgot to put connected. We have three connected components. So in each connected component of omega, so like D0 is a connected component of omega, D1 is another connected component of omega, and D2 is the third connected component, okay, of omega. Now, the index function is very interesting. It is integer value, so the value can be only 0, 1, minus 1, 2, 3, 100, a million, a billion, okay? Minus 3, minus 5. Or integer. Positive, 0, or negative. Possible, right? And but in each component, in each connected component, for example, in D0, all Z has the same value. Okay? All Z have the same value. And this is an integer. Alright, in D1, all the Z in D1 has the same index. Okay? And the same for all point in D2. Okay, so that is the same, right? And which is 0, okay, in the unbounded component. Which one is the unbounded component in this situation? D0. D0 is unbounded, right? Because we could own everything out. So the index of any point, of every point in D0 is 0. Okay? It is 0. Is that clear about the theorem? So, so for here, index of point. So we have, let me write it down. In this case, the index is 0. And here, the index is 1 for all, and here is 2 for all. Okay, I will explain. Okay, the theorem explains why points in the unbounded component as index 0, okay? Because it is stated by the theorem. And later on, show to you with a practical method to say to you that point here in D1 is index 1, and point here in D2 is index 2. This is the reason why I put the index here, 0, 1, 2, right? On purpose. Okay? On purpose. Alright. So, alright, and also I give a detailed proof, okay, in my supplemental material. So again, I skip it. Okay? But please see the proof. And I would like to give a remark to explain why the index is sometimes called a winding number. Okay? So we explain why the index is called the winding number. Means the number of times, the closed paths, gamma, wind around Z, wind around Z. So one round is one, and two round is two, right? So round means just like a circle, it's a round, okay? Alright, so let the cross curve you can write the cross curve in this way. The difference has the amplitude, right? By the polar form and T alpha beta. So alpha beta is the parameter interval of the cross path. So the difference, I just write the difference, becomes to, this is just the absolute value of the difference, and this is just the phase of this difference. Okay. Right? Where rho t, equal to gamma t, gamma t z, it's a continuous. A continuous distance function. And theta of t, a continuous phase function. The reason why rho t and theta t are continuous is because path is continuous by definition. Okay? The path is continuous by definition. So that's why they are continuous. But both rho t and theta t are piecewise continuously differentiable on alpha beta. Okay, the reason is because that the gamma t is piecewise continuously differentiable. So then gamma from t is equal to rho from t vi theta t plus rho t I theta from t and e I theta by the chain rule, right? So by chain rule, we have that. Now, except, of course, except possibly on a finite state. It's where gamma is not differentiable. All right, so, and then we will see gamma from P divided by gamma P minus Z is equal to so gamma from P divided by this difference. Okay? Right? When we do this, we find that this is equal to rho from P divided by rho P times I theta from P. Okay? Alpha theta, possibly, okay? Set minus the finite state S. So that, okay, so that by definition, 2 pi r index gamma z is equal to alpha gamma from p gamma p minus z and p. Okay? Yeah, so this is one. So this non integral actually is equal to this integral. Okay? Right. And so we have alpha, this is rho from P, rho P, D P plus I. So we have alpha. Theta from P and P. Okay? Is that okay? Any questions? I'll wait for you. All right, now, this is the logarithm, right? Okay. And for beta alpha, and the I alpha, and actually this is P theta, P, right? Is the change of theta as T move on, right? So this is the angle. And can you see that this is the beta minus plus I. No. But this is equal to zero. The reason is that gamma alpha is equal to gamma beta because it's closed. Right, so gamma alpha is equal to gamma beta, so that rho alpha and rho beta are the same. Okay, things. Okay, so this is zero. This part is zero, vanished. Okay, and so this is become to. Right. So that we conclude that 2 pi times is equal to, this is the total angle, okay? The total angle is wave, okay, by the phasor gamma t and z from t equal to alpha to t equal to beta. So this is the total angle, so you can see that. So, for example, if this is the point here, and so we have a phasor here. So this is gamma t, okay? Z is fixed. This is the phasor. Now, as t goes on, you sweep, right? This is the angle. You know that? The angle is theta here. So, for example, if you go to here, this is the d theta, and here is comma t plus theta t. So you have delta theta here. Okay, so as t from t to t plus theta t, you swept the this phasor, sweep, okay, sweeps this small amount of angle, right? And this one accumulates, right? This is integral, so you accumulate all the angles. Okay, and so this is increasing the angle, but here you increase the angle again. Alright, see here. Suppose we start from here, and this is increasing. So theta becomes bigger and bigger up to this point. Okay, and then you go back here, so the angle decreases, right? Decrease again, and then here, and then increase again, and come here. You one round, right? So that's why the index is one, because the angle is too high. Can you see that? Okay, how about here? Suppose I test another point in D2. So in D2 here, suppose I take this Z here, so the phasor is here. Okay? Now you go this way. Right? So now you go. You go this way, right? Go there. Go to here. Up to here. Okay? So, and there. So you have two wrong, right? Or you can start from here. I think it's better. You start from here, right? Maybe it's better you start from here. Come from here. Maybe you start from this point. Okay? You start from this point. Now the phasor go up. So increase, up to here, 2π, right? With one round, you have 2π. And then you go in another 2π, right? So you have two pi, so it's 4π. So the winding number is 2. You can see it, right? You can see what is called a winding number by using the phasors. Interesting, right? This is a geometric object. Okay? So this is why the index is called a winding number. Okay? The number of times that the phasor sweep, okay, and go around the point Z. Okay, and questions about the introduction of the concept of index. Okay. Now there are some special cases that you are able to find out the index. So, for example, suppose that omega is convex open set in the complex plane. Gamma is a closed pad, in omega. Okay, so gamma is in the complex open set. Now, if A is not in the omega, so the situation, so let me draw the situation here. A typical convex open set is just a disk, right? So you can think about a disk. So this is omega. And you have a closed pad, so maybe, so you have a closed pad here, so this is gamma. Here, you have gamma star. And the A here, A is outside of the omega. Okay, so this is the situation of this example, right? So omega is a convex open set, so it's convex. And the gamma is a closed curve, a closed pi space inside the open set omega. And if A is not here, the convex function fz equal to 1 over z minus a. This complex function actually is analytic omega, because that z minus a neighbor 0. Okay, so you can find its derivative very easily. You can find the derivative, so it is analytical omega. Now we can use the Cauchy's integral theorem. In a convex open set. Actually, I think this is a theorem for C. So applying the Cauchy's integral theorem in the last section, we have that the line integral is 0. The line integral is 0. Okay? So this implies that the index of gamma of A, which is 2 pi I, is 0. So the index is 0. The following theorem provides reasonably efficient method of finding the index of a point with respect to a cross curve, across the head, it is a little bit technical, but very useful. Of course, you can use phase though, if the cross path is not very complicated, you can use the way that I just show you, right? Use the phase, so you can get the index at each point. But this theorem is quite useful if you face with complicated cross curve. across the path. Okay. So we will use D, A, R, the open disk. Okay, with the center at A and radius off. And we also use D bar, A R, to be the closed disk. Okay, with center at A and radius up. Okay. But this is just notation that I will use that. Okay, so now I will state a theorem 14.3.b. Okay. So comma a closed path. Okay. In the compass plane. Okay, with the parameter interval from up to beta. Okay, so gamma is just a cross path in the compass plane, just like here. You can even think about this is a model of our cross curve. Okay, and then alpha and beta is the parameter interval. And we suppose we can find the alpha, U and V and beta. So in between the end to end point alpha and beta, we find the 2 points, U and V. Suppose and A and B, we find A and B are complex numbers. With the okay and B, the magnitude of B is equal to R. Of course, is positive. And we find so maybe I will draw another picture. Okay, so and 1 gamma U is equal to A minus B, gamma V equal to A plus B. Okay, 2, second, the absolute value of gamma X minus A is this thing R, even only if U is that S less than B, right? So this is, I will explain later what do you mean or this is only if either S equal to U or S equal to V. Okay. Alright, so let me draw the situation we have. We may have okay, like that. Oops. Okay. Right. And we find here this is a comma, so probably this way, okay. So we have comma U here, comma V here. Okay. Right. So because that we find two T equal U and V here. Okay. So gamma U gamma B. Okay. And so now, what is A and B? Well, we have we can make a line segment here, and the middle point here, right? Take the middle point actually is A. Maybe too small. Maybe I put A here. So this is the middle point. So A is the middle point of the line segment. Gamma U to gamma V. Okay, so it's a middle point here. Now it's the middle point, so now we can write this one, and so the difference, so we can write that U is A minus B, and this is A plus B. Okay, so what is B? Well, B is the difference between gamma V and A, right? The difference. So B, what is B? Actually, B is B actually is equal to V minus A. Okay, the difference. So we have the situation. Actually, gamma U is A minus B. Gamma V is A plus B. Okay, and then I construct a disk. So I construct disk. So now, okay. So the center is here. So now I construct a disk. So the diameter is R. Okay, so R is equal to the magnitude of B, right? Just as I say, right? Because B is the difference of these two points. So the length R is just the length of B. Okay. And so we have a point here. So this is R. R is the radius. Okay, A is this point, okay? Now this point is, what is this point? Well, so this is A plus B, right? So if you turn, add a 90 degree, so here you have A plus B I, correct? Because I means you turn around for 90 degrees, right? So A, think about it's a vector, okay? A is the point, the vector here, right? And B is another vector. And you turn the vector by 90 degrees, right? So you go to here. So this point you have. Okay? So the vector point of view of Cox number is not very useful, right? This time. And so, of course, here you have A minus BI, of course. Because minus I is you turn the point clockwise, right? Clockwise means minus 90 degrees. So you go this way. Alright, so this is antipodal, right? This point is here, this point is here. Is that okay? And so the meaning is, the first one is means that gamma U, gamma V, we use gamma U, gamma V to construct A and B, right? To know what is A and what is B. The second condition says that, okay, the only the this is the second the arc, right? The parts that when S run from U to V, so U to V here, only these parts is inside this disk, right? No other part can be inside here. So you select this disk, quite small, right? Quite small. You cannot select a disk that big, right? Then you will expose other parts. Okay, so the second part means that you have this situation. No other part of the curve can traverse through this disk. Is that okay? Right, so you have that. And the two endpoint here, right? The two endpoint is the only point that you have the distance of from A is equal to R. So this is 1, 2, 3, and all this, all right? All these conditions 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 can be explained by this figure. Is that okay? Exactly. The statement is just to describe this situation only. Okay? All right, now, so assume, furthermore, okay, so assume furthermore that the DAR is this open disk, right? DAR minus gamma star. Alright, so this is gamma star here. Alright, so it's the union, right, of two domains. Right, and we label D minus, D plus, and D minus labeled. Okay, so we have two parts. Okay, so this part, the disk minus gamma, minus the white arc here, right? Is this part. This part will be denoted as D minus. And this part will be denoted as D plus. So this D minus D plus here. Okay, so label so that A plus B I, so A plus B I here, okay, it belongs to B plus, the closure of B plus. Closure means that B plus including the boundaries here. So the boundary include this part, the yellow curve, and the white curve. Okay. And A minus B I is in B minus bar, okay? So this is the situation. Or you can say that, you can say as as gamma t traverse, okay? So as gamma t traverses, right? Traverse this disk in R from A minus B from gamma U A minus B to gamma V A plus B. Right? So if we go there, then D minus, okay, so D minus is on the right hand side, right? You go on the right hand side. So D minus is on the right side, on the right, okay? And E plus is on the left. you can. This is another way. Okay, so D minus always on the right, and the D plus on the left. Okay, so this is called the way here. Then, very interesting, the conclusion is that the index of Z, okay, is equal to 1 plus index gamma of W for all Z in D plus and all W in D minus. Okay, so points in D minus here, in D plus is 1 more than the index of points in D minus here. So point on the left has 1 more index than the point on the right. So just remember this diagram, okay? This diagram is will be okay. Anyway, points here, right, and there. So this left side has index one more than the right on the right. Right? So this is the situation. So, give me an example. So the statement of the theorem is a little bit longer, right? It's very technical, but very useful, you know, very useful. So, so now consider gamma a simple closed curve, a path, simple closed path. Remember, a simple closed path means that the path does not intersect itself, right? So this is the situation. Here, so this is gamma. So you have D0 and D1. Okay? D0, only two components, because it's simple, right? So that the C minus gamma star equal to D0 and D1. Okay? Okay, and now suppose that so there are two orientations. So this is the so maybe I use maybe I write in and out, okay? So this is the sense that I use in out spacer. So this is in, this is the out, okay? In and out, yeah, okay? Right, so they are domains. Domain means open connected set. Okay, so if D out is on the right, so if D out is on the right, okay, as gamma of P traverses the compass plane. So suppose this is the way that, right? This way that the D out is on the right, right? On the right. Okay, so then the plane. Sometimes people say that I need gamma T moves. counterclockwise. Sometimes people say that. Okay, counterclockwise. Then we have, index gamma of z equal to 1 plus index gamma of w for all z in the inside, for all w in the outside, be up. Okay? But by our theorem, 40.3.8, this is zero. Always zero, right? Because it is an unbounded component. So dr is unbounded. The unbounded component. Okay? So the winding number is zero. So this implies that a conclusion is that the index of z is equal to 1 for all z in the inside, in this case. So we have to know that it now is 1. The other hand, if d out, right, is on the left, for example, here, you go this way, so the out is left, right? So you have D out, D in. Okay, so if D out is on the left, as gamma T traverses the compass frame, i.e. gamma T moves clockwise. Right? In this case, we have the index of gamma W is 1 plus the index gamma of V for all W in out, because now D out is on the left. So the left hand side has more index, right? By our theorem, we can do it. So, and for all z in the in. But again, this is zero, right? This is zero. From the winding number theorem, this is zero. So in this case, you find the index of gamma of z is minus 1 here. This is minus 1. Okay, for all z in D in. Okay? So the orientation matters, right? Even though you have the same simple curves paths, but the orientation, if you have different orientation, the index for points inside of the paths, okay, will have different index. Either is positive 1 or minus 1. Okay? Alright, so let's take a short break for 5 minutes now. Huh?